out of your systems. And again, because of the variety of data, this becomes a huge challenge. Passwords, of course, the grounds for everybody, so many systems. I'm sure that each and every one sitting over here would be remembering at least 2 to 3 passwords, at least, in their own organizations. This again becomes because of, again, remember the thing that I said earlier, huge volume of data and huge variety of data. So it's not just data restricted to one system, one SAP, one ERP, one CRM. No. Spread across the entire data landscape of the organization. So you are going through multiple levels of authentication. People forget, people write down, people share. Risk number 6, paper. Now, big data doesn't exclude paper in any manner. Most of the companies, what they do, they scan it, put it into the system and do some OCR and put some metadata on it to be able to come to know what that data scan was all about. That's what happens. Mostly HR. Right? Who's going to save all those huge files, thousands of employees? That's what even we say. Scan it, keep it, do an OCR, put some metadata on it. So, but the point is, what happens to the paper after that? More often than not, pass by any company that you can think of, go by the printer, departmental printer, there will be a stack of paper. So this paper, when it is scanned, in any organization you will see, what do you see? You see shredders. How many? I can rarely, if ever, remember a shredder being used. It's there lying, they'll put it in some cabinet and it's just there. Now, the state of affairs, as per the Verizon DBIR report, database research intrusion reports, there is 92% of the breaches from external entity involved external actors. This is up to massive databases. I'm not talking about a small time organizations. 52% involved hacking, 40% involved malware, 76 exploited weak or stolen credentials, 76%. 29 leveraged social tactics, 75 had apparently financial motives. Now, let's look at two things. One is leveraged social tactics, that is nothing more than social engineering. Ask yourself a question. I can see most of you sitting over a large organization. Ask yourself a question. When was the last time a social engineering check or assessment was done within your organization? Most of you would say, yes, we've had a VAPT done, a web assessment was done. When was the last time you were assessed from social engineering perspective? It's very easy. Social engineering, just to summarize in a line, uses the human being's inherent way of trusting. Humans have inherent characteristics to trust people. If he says, see Sunil from IT department, then he must be from the IT department. Number B looks local. So again, weak or stolen credentials, you've heard of Target, right? The second largest chain of stores in the US. They are on the breach of collapse with class action suits. They were hacked because of stolen credentials. As I said in the first slide, it is also outsourcing vendors. You know how they got hacked? Such a massive database, all the data gone. It happened because they had outsourced their management of their building management system, BMS. They had outsourced it to a vendor. That vendor was connecting from the internet, and this BMS network was not segregated from their local networks. So this guy used to log in from remote and do the checks and the preventive maintenance checks or whatever be the case. But that network is also integrated with the local network. There was no segregation that he cannot come from outside to in and stuff. And that vendor, to simplify ease of access, was using a single user ID password across all their clients. So the hacker simply had to compromise that single user ID password or get it from someone, and they were into Target. No hacking involved, no expertise, what you see in Die Hard 4 or Mission Impossible, hanging ulta sort of a thing, where a bead of sweat falling down can trigger an alarm. Nothing on those lines. It is all taken care of. What do the industry experts have to say? Look at this. Cisco saying, data security is compromised through unintentional and unwise behavior of employees, primarily, and IT professionals. It's not talking about outside hackers. Primary focus of people, when you're speaking about data security, big data, small data, whatever be the case, is always, what if somebody hacks into my organization? That's not the case. Your internal people are your biggest threat. This is Cisco. traditional control approach, there is general controls, application controls, process control, and control design, preventive, detective, and of course, responsive or corrective. We'll get into this, not much because everybody knows about this. What is the challenge? The challenge is this. Are you putting the horse before the cart or the cart before the horse? Many times the controls are defined that this is what we will do from information security in our organization and then apply it across all your data bits. Huge mistake when you have such a huge data on the lines of big data. You cannot use a DBMS control over, say, mobile data or video data or even paper as a data or as an information source. What really needs to be done is actual and specific controls over data resources. That maybe that is what you do. What you need to do is map the actual and specific vulnerabilities to data and then define a control. In other words, you need to have a very strong risk analysis system in place. Identify the controls based on the vulnerabilities for a specific process or an asset. Typically speaking, in most organizations that we see is that controls are designed and then everybody else has to fall in line with it. The controls may not be required or may not map exactly to that data set. So what is the suggested methodology? When you are having large unstructured data, it could be banks, it could be manufacturing, it could be pharma, so many things. There is data flow analysis techniques that can help data leakage, that's what I am speaking on today. Assessment of data leakage risk, analysis of big data flows, threat scenario and DLP tools. I'll look on the first and the last. These are the five steps. And we'll get into this in detail. Investigation and data gathering, process mapping, threat analysis. The number one is investigation and data gathering. This is the one that is always missed, whether you're working internally or hiring a consultant. In our language, we call it as an initial system study. Before you start working on a system, have you understood the system? The consultant directly comes and does a risk analysis based on asset inventory. Is it all this time? Am I right in saying that? I can see so many people shaking it. Okay, give us your asset inventory. That's not how it's supposed to leave to happen. Has the consultant understood, or your internal people? You are such big organizations. It's not possible that IT wala would know everything. Whomsoever is a risk assessment champion in our organization, has he understood your organization in totality to be able to do a risk analysis? It could also be that you set up a risk management team comprising of various business unit heads. Typically, again, I refer back to the panel, it always falls in the lap of IT. IT or risk analysis, IT only currently. On what basis? Does IT know what is the criticality of your data? Maybe in the finance, in the treasury, in the marketing, in the sales? They don't. The process mapping. What is it that you have as of now? Whether it is input, processing and output, the three stages of data processing. Overlay of business, paper business documents, electronic data, identify transfer points of data, and identify the data house. That is, in other words, asset identification. You first identified what you need to do, then what is the setup all about, then you identified your asset data within the organization using various process flows, data flows. So far, in other words, what we do is that very critical in a big data scenario, especially, what you need to do is that instead of asking them for the asset inventory, what we do, chart out all the processes. Look at, okay, now what do you need for doing this process? What is the information that you need for this process? That becomes one of the aspects of asset inventory. Second thing, what infrastructure is required for this particular process? That becomes another part of your asset inventory. And that builds up from there. In a big data scenario, since it's no longer restricted to just one or two servers or one or two, databases, this becomes an acutely big problem. Threat analysis, finally coming into identifying the threat and the vulnerabilities. You know what I mean, the TV mapping that is required to be done. What can go wrong purposely or accidentally? And the thought process when doing a risk analysis, especially when there are large data sets, the point that is said is, No, nobody will do something so foolish, yaar. Come on. You cannot expect somebody to behave in such a foolish manner. But how many times have you seen fools being actually ingenious in the way that they are doing foolish things? Very few people I have seen in my career, I have been working for like 23 years now. And rarely, if at all, rarely, I would say, not I would say if at all, rarely you find somebody intentionally doing malpractices with data security. More often than not, the person simply doesn't care, or he is simply not aware of what needs to be done. It was an intentional, or in many cases, you know, as you must have heard the saying, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. So he wanted to do something good. So he bypassed this process in a good way, not in a sarcastic way. But that was actually counterproductive to the organization, because that person was simply not aware of what could have gone wrong. After that, we get into designing the controls. The same thing applies to the big data, but in a much more different manner. Electronic data flows in and out, applying controls to that, paper data, databases, paper storage, remember that, that's what I said. You scan and keep it, but then what happens to that paper data? Because nobody wants to take the responsibility of having signed on the paper record disposal form. You getting what I'm saying? Who is going to sign off on the shredding of these papers? So it is just lying. Make it the next rule so we can put more paper. It's all there on the system also. Third party vendors, your weakest link in the chain again would also be your third party vendors. Many a time it is on L1, you know what I mean, lowest cost. They come in your organization, this is what you've seen many places. Within your own organization, you've got solid controls for doing a background check, reference check, admin check, all those things. But when you're hiring people from outside as third party, what is the checks you've done? Oh, we asked them to sign an NDA. Really? And that person is getting paid 6,000, 7,000, 8,000. What do you expect? Design the control. Again, in the case of big data, I will tell you, there is prevention, detection, and of course response, that is corrective action. Understand one thing, that in the big data scenario, especially in the big data scenario, what happens is a theft is happening only in the case of data being copied out. Many people are looking for, you know, some sort of evidence that data got deleted, data got corrupted, data got, you know, changed. But in most cases where hacks have actually happened, they have simply copied the data. And in most of the companies that you've seen, the alarm light in the head goes up only when some data is deleted or some sort of data gets overwritten and stuff. Now, the last thing is the technical capabilities. Now, this could be one of the solutions that can take care of data leakage within an organization, that's a DLP. But understand, in my experience working across Indian diaspora, there is very few, if I can count it at one hand, companies have actually done a proper DLP solution. Many of these people who sell DLP, they are mostly con artists. They will come, hum laga denge sir, discovery board mein laga denge, baad mein us pe rules dal denge. What the hell, your data landscape changes on a regular basis. In many cases, DLP is used only as an endpoint control. Who puts USB, who doesn't put USB, and what is get printed and what doesn't get printed. Not what is getting printed, who can print and who cannot print. That is nothing more than endpoint management, but that is not what a DLP is all about. In the US, in other developed countries, I have seen, a DLP is actually as process as an ERP being rolled out within the organization. Takes the same amount of time, takes the same amount of expertise, because you have to map out all the data, who can do what with what data, in what mannerism. Very few within this country have actually, in my opinion and experience, have taken the time and energy to do it. So DLP is simply not running it in discovery mode and putting the rules that they show. It is doing an entire data flow analysis, charting out the data, mapping out the data. This is one of the things that can really help you in a big data scenario. Because a DLP systems are there if set up correctly. And again, it's not just a one-time thing. Because your data, which is very confidential today, 2 months on the line may not be that confidential. And data which is not confidential today, 2 months on the line is very confidential because of some changes that happens. But if your DLP setup remains the same, then what's the case? And especially in the case of big data, where data is varied, huge volumes of data is being pumped into the organization, that magnifies the problem even more. sample deliverables against data flow mapping, customer information risk assessment, and threat scenario analysis. I'm not getting to this, I'm running out of time. And she's showing me all the various signs. So, anyway, recap to meeting the big data challenge with regards to data leakage. Volume, that is layered controls to protect, detect what is there. There is velocity, with the velocity of data, this is a technical challenge. Again, variety, veracity, again, this all requires effective controls. You may even need to have a compliance team who is mapping out data that is rushing within the organization at that pace. It cannot be just buying some space on Teradata and looking at their MIS reports. That's not how it moves. And that's what I've seen in many companies as big data. So anyway, thank you for your time. I'm just nearing the end of it. And I'll quote my favorite philosopher, that is Nicomedes. I really appreciate this. It is, it's not the answer, but it's a question that enlightens. So unless you have, I evaluate people, especially when they're coming in for an interview, based on the questions that they ask. So if you have a question, I'll be more than happy to take it. I still have, okay, I've got a good gentleman in the back. Somebody can hand him a mic. And on your chairs, there would be a feedback sheet. You can fill it. We have 3 lucky draws coming up. So you can fill it, you can give it at a stall outside, just on the way out, this time for second on the left. We had one yesterday, there is 3 today, so there is 3 times more the chance, so. Yes.
Now, like we have software companies who are rated against the capability maturity model, like CMM3, okay. CMMI, etc.
Yes.
Now, as a customer, I would like to know what should be or what is the grade of security that any organization has implemented. So, is there any such grading that occurs, or can there be any such grading with respect to cyber security?
I wish. Okay. Okay, let me rephrase the question. That's a good question that she asked. That is, in software development, they have the standards, level 1, level 2, 3, 4, 5, CMM, level 5, I, and stuff like that. Is there some way in which you can grade companies based on their information security posture, especially when it's a good software development company where you outsourced most of your operations and stuff, how do you do it? Honestly speaking, no. Because you have 27,000 ones and all those things. So what is, I would suggest to companies is that have an internal ITGC model, IT general controls, which includes information security also. Make your own control mapping. And on the, because for companies like Novartis and all, we have done it. But again, that's a hugely mature organization. So you can have your own ITGC controls for your organization and apply it to the clients that is there. So somebody like a Tata has it. So if your organization is really serious about ranking your vendors and even yourself based on the security stance, I would suggest a very good ITDC. Don't just rely just on ISO 27001. I don't believe it is complete. Especially if you're somebody dealing into the BFSI segment or a software development organization, especially I should say. So you should have accumulation. And if you're coming under foreign regulation, that becomes all the more worse. If you're coming under SSE 16 or HIPAA and CSE and all those things, it becomes all the more worse. That's why we say, for organizations, we're really looking at how your